So this is a demonstration, a detailed demonstration of the structures which are located in the entire anterior abdominal wall. So let's start with the most superficial structure after we have reflected the skin. This is the superficial fascia. Abdominal wall has got two layers, the outer fatty layer, most of which has been removed, and that is called the Camper's fascia. And just deep to that is this layer, which we can see. This is the membranous Scarpa's fascia, which also we have reflected. What we see in front of us is the abdominal wall with the fascia removed. So let's start off with the three flat muscles of the abdomen. The first muscle that we see here, this is the external oblique muscle. This is on the right side of the cadaver. We have done a detailed dissection on the right side, and we can see that the direction of fibers are running down and medially like this. It is like as if the hands are in the pocket. So this is the external oblique muscle. It takes origin from the 5th to the 12th ribs, and it also takes origin from the outer limb of the iliac crest. And the fibers, medially, they form part of the rectus sheath, which I'm going to describe a little later. And inferiorly, the fibers, they form, the aponeurosis forms this structure here. This is a very important structure. It's called the inguinal ligament. It extends from the anterior superior iliac spine and ends at the pubic tubercle. So this is the extent of the external oblique aponeurosis. So the proximal portion of the muscle is fleshy, and the medial and the inferior portion is aponeurotic, as we can see very clearly here. Now we have split open the external oblique muscle, and I'm reflecting it now. And once I reflect it, we can see much more clearly the inguinal ligament. And this is, my finger is running along the inguinal ligament, which is the inferior free upturned margin of the aponeurosis of the external oblique. And this is the anterior superior leg spine here, and this is the pubic tubercle here. So this is the full extent of the inguinal ligament. Having reflected the external oblique, both laterally and medially, we see the next muscle. And this is the internal oblique muscle. The internal oblique muscle has got fibers which are in the opposite direction. The fibers are running upwards and medially. So this is like as if the patient has got his hands crossed and over to the opposite side of the chest like that. So this is the, however, if you look further lower down, we notice that the fibers are not directed upward and medially, they are instead directed downwards and medially. But the bulk of the fibers are directed upwards and medially. So this is the internal oblique muscle. This one takes origin from the middle lip of the iliac crest. And it also takes origin from the lateral half of the inguinal ligament. Therefore, it also forms part of the anterior wall of the inguinal canal, which I mentioned just now. And the fibers then go medially, and they also help to form the rectus sheath, which I'm going to describe. And they get inserted onto also the 10th and 11th and 12th ribs. So this is the internal oblique. Now I'm going to reflect the internal oblique. I'm reflecting the medial half of the internal oblique, and I'm reflecting the lateral half of the internal oblique. And once we reflect it, we see the third muscle of the abdomen, and this is the transversus abdominis. And this also we notice the fibers are running transversely, that's why it's called transversus abdominis, and just like the other two muscles, medially they become aponeurotic. The point to be noted here is that we notice numerous nerves running along with arteries. Neurovascular structures are running. This is the neurovascular plane. That is the plane between the second layer of muscle, internal oblique, and the third layer of muscle, the transversus abdominis. The transversus abdominis also takes origin from the inner lip of the iliac crest. And it also takes origin from the lower ribs. And it also takes origin from the lateral 1/4 of the inguinal ligament. And the fibers then converge medially, and they become aponeurotic, and they also help to form the rectus sheath, which I'm going to describe just now. So this is the, these are the three flat muscles. So what are the functions of these three flat muscles of the abdomen? They help to maintain the intra-abdominal pressure. They maintain the tone, and they help to contain the abdominal contents in place. And whenever we do any maneuver to increase the intra-abdominal pressure, like for example coughing, sneezing, or straining at micturition or defecation, it is these muscles which are responsible. And the nerve supply of these muscles is the thoracoabdominal nerves, and we can see the thoracoabdominal nerves here. We can see some of them. As I told you, they run in the neurovascular plane. The thoracoabdominal nerves are T7 to 11 and the subcostal nerve T12, which run from the intercostal and they come and supply the abdomen. So therefore, above the umbilicus, which is here, is T7, 8, 9. At the level of the umbilicus is T10, and below the umbilicus till the inguinal ligament is T11 and 12. And below that, of course, is the inguinal. So this is the quick nerve supply and the function of the flat muscles of the abdomen. Finally, a few quick words about some abdominal incisions that are done in surgery. Nowadays, most of the elective surgeries that are performed are by laparoscopy. However, there are some indications when we do have to do open up the abdomen, which is known as laparotomy, and that is when there is a failed laparoscopic surgery, or when there is a penetrating blunt trauma with internal injury, or when there is cancer, or when there is generalized peritonitis. These are some of the situations when we do have to open up the abdomen. So what are the incisions that we make? The quickest is the midline incision through the linea alba. It can be supraumbilical, infraumbilical. This gives very rapid approach. The thing about incision in the linea alba is that when we're closing it, because the linea alba is relatively avascular, we have to close it with non-absorbable material. I personally prefer nylon loop, and that gives a very strong repair. I have seen people repairing with absorbable material, and the patient comes back with an incisional hernia 1 year later. So the incision is a paramedian incision. That is, just like we have done here, split open the anterior layer of the rectus sheath, retract the rectus abdominis laterally, because the nerves are coming from the lateral aspect. So we do not retract them medially, we retract them laterally. And then we split the posterior layer of rectus sheath and we can enter the abdomen. So this is the paramedian incision. Again, right, left, supraumbilical, infraumbilical. Some places, some surgeons prefer an incision by the side of the rectus abdominis, and this line which we said was a linea semilunaris, and that incision, which is not very commonly used, is referred to as the Battle's pararectal incision. So this is another incision that is used in children. When we are doing a surgery for the abdomen and we do a laparotomy, we don't use vertical incisions. We use supraumbilical horizontal incision because it gives much better access and it is much easier to repair. And when we repair all the three layers of the abdominal muscles together. A few special incisions are also used, especially if there's a failed laparoscopy. And one of them is an incision parallel to the right subcostal margin. And that is known as a Cocker's incision, which is used for the right lobe of the liver and especially for the gallbladder. We have an incision for appendix, and that incision is referred to as McBurney's gridiron incision. Now that is done in the case of appendicectomy when we cannot do it by laparoscopic procedure. The landmarks for that incision is, if this is the anterior superiliac spine and this is the umbilicus, we draw a line, that's called the spino-umbilical line, and we take the junction between the lateral 1/3 and the medial 2/3. So approximately at this location, we cut the external oblique, and then we do not cut the rest of the muscle. We just split the fibers. The next muscle that we see here is the internal oblique, and what we have done here is we have actually split it. And then what we see underneath will be the transverse abdominis, then we split that and we can enter and we reach the cecum and the appendix. This incision is referred to as the McBurney's gridiron incision. And last but not the least, in females, when we have to do a cesarean section, we do an incision parallel to the just above the pubic bone here like this. And we incise and then we separate the two rectus muscles and then we split open the fascia transversalis and the parietal peritoneum, and we can reach the pelvis. So this incision is not visible because it is below the line of the bikini. That's why in common parlance it is referred to as the bikini incision, but technically it is referred to as the fan and steel incision or the suprapubic incision. So these are some of the incisions that we do. One more thing I wanted to mention is something called incisional hernias and other hernias. I already mentioned about the incisional hernia in the region of the linea alba if it is not repaired properly. Incisional hernia can occur anywhere if it has not been repaired properly and there's a muscle weakness or the nerve has been cut. We can have hernia coming out through the umbilicus, and that is not very uncommon in children. That is known as the umbilical hernia. In 93% of cases, the umbilical hernia in children closes by 1 year of age, so it does not require any surgery. Only 7% of them require surgery, and that has to be repaired. In adults, the hernia does not come out through the umbilicus. It comes by the side of the umbilicus, usually above the umbilicus, just above. It is known as para-umbilical hernia. This difference is very important, and umbilical hernia is common in children. Para-umbilical hernia occurs in adults. In umbilical hernia, the umbilicus is at the apex of the hernial sac. In para-umbilical hernia, the umbilicus is at the wall of the umbilical sac. So that occurs only in para-umbilical, occurs only in adults. In many thin-walled individuals, we can see a gap between the superior rectus above the umbilicus. And especially when you ask them to lift up the head from the bed without using their hands, you'll see a bulge. That is referred to as a divarication of recti, which is usually commonly seen in the upper part of the abdomen. So these are some of the incisional and other ventral hernias that we can get in the abdominal wall, depending on what situation it is. So that is all for now. Thank you very much for watching. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. Have a nice day.